How important has your faith been? It's been a tough past couple weeks.
It's kind of what's guided me. I think it's what's guided this community in the days. And so it's everything. I mean, I think there's been a lot to bear for this community. And I think that lets us know that we can be okay and we can bear it.
You had some long days, some tense moments. Prayer an important part of all this?
Prayer's been an everyday part of it. It's a continued part. I probably put a little extra time in praying.
So your faith has really given you the strength and the courage to keep going during all this time?
It has. Without it, I don't know where I'd be. I don't know where my family would be. Without it, I don't know where our community would be in this nation. So I think that...
And the ministers that moved in during the time, things were pretty tense. Was that important?
That was real important. And I think the first day the ministers were here, they came rushing out, and they weren't really identified as far as their shirts or their collars or so forth. But I think when they actually put on their the symbol of their faith in the church, is that it made a difference. And it's made a big difference. And they've been out here ever since.
Thank you for the testimony you've demonstrated.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Yeah. Please, can we get a clear path? Please, can we get a clear path through here?
Praise the Lord. Up here.
What does your sign say?
Oh, Green Time TV. The station, you ever heard Station 24?
Yes. God bless you. You're right out in the middle of it, aren't you?
Right.
That's fantastic. Well, it's good to see you out here today. And this is great to be out here among the people raising the voices, right?
Absolutely. Yes, we're very happy to be here. We have a whole Green Party contingency.
That's great. Well, why do you feel so strong about this?
Well, it's so strong because basically the county prosecutor, Bob McCullough, is giving the green light to police to go ahead and kill young black people. He's saying we're not going to prosecute, we're going to stall. Anybody else who commits a murder, point blank, is going to be arrested. And he's saying he's not going to arrest him. The governor, Jay Nixon, is saying the same thing. He's not going to appoint a special prosecutor. Basically, they're saying that police can kill young black men and nothing is going to happen to them. And that is a fundamental issue. Everything else is a side issue.
Thank you. What do you want Missouri to wake up to?
Wake up to everything. Wake up to the racial discrimination, the profiling, as well as the voter suppression laws and health care as well.
And what about the traffic courts and the big money they're making off of that?
They're making big money off of everything. Everything that's not right for the people. I also think that they need to make changes to our educational system. I think that there's obviously a connect between the fact that schools are being shut down in the inner city, but yet we have prisons being built and everything's privatized. It's just all wrong.
It's been weeks since Michael Brown's death, and yet the people are continuing to rally, continuing to march. You feel this is going to be going on for a while?
Yeah, this isn't going away. So to people who think that this is just for show, this is not going away.
But there's some real deep issues that need to be dealt with.
Yes, there's definitely some deep issues that have been going on in the United States for hundreds of years. St. Louis just turned 250 years old, and we're about 251 years overdue.
Yes, St. Louis, as it celebrates its birthday, has not dealt with these issues. It's not just Ferguson. We see St. Louis City and the racial discrimination there and all these municipalities, it seems like, in the county.
Exactly. And we're calling for reform to all of these municipalities and how they make their money and how they support themselves, because it's basically off of the backs of black people, and it's not right.
I feel justice needs to be served, and I feel, you know, as the right as a people, that we all need to vote, prayer, and just be educated about a lot of different things.
I'm just out here to support and hope justice be served, and think everyone should come together and stick together like this for now on, not just today, but every day.
Came out here when he was laying out, when they had him. Why would they leave him laying out there 4 hours after he shot?
We don't know. That's the questions and answers we're still asking. So.
Was his mother around while that was going on?
Yes, she was here. She was crying, hysterical, wanting to see her son, you know, talking to the police, but they really wouldn't give her no answers.
The police wouldn't give her any answers?
No.
So, I mean, it's hard to see this unfold like this, and I don't think a lot of people understand. There are all kinds of rumors circulating, all kinds of stuff going on right now.
Lies being told.
Lots of lies being told.
A lot of stuff. It seems
that people would just come down here and talk to the people, meet with the people. You find out what the facts are.
Exactly.
But just listening to a lot of lies out there by a lot of people that just don't want to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to get there.
Yeah. I feel like if a lot of people just come out and listen instead of talk, you have to listen. You know, people be want to be heard, and it's a lot of people that don't want to listen. They just want to talk, you know. So
we need to listen and pray, right?
Yes, exactly.
Today is really important. I don't want this to be a black, white, red, or brown issue. I mean, we all have to stand in this fight together. If we've got the race card, but the atrocities and the damage that police are doing across this country to everyone of every color, creed, and race, is really criminal. So people need to find out what this really is about. The abuse across this entire country affecting all of us.
We are all Mike Brown. Don't shoot.
Mm-hmm.
What do you want to say through that message?
I just feel like we're part of him. We need justice, something done about it.
This happened a number of weeks back, but it looks like people are continuing.
Yes. When it's wrong, right is right, and it's wrong. So we're going to stand for what's right.
So even though weeks have passed, you're still not giving up, are you?
No way. We're going to go all the way to the end, to justice is served. Yeah.
As we study this to try to find out, well, what led up to all this? It seems like the municipal courts, like in Ferguson, their number two source of revenue is the tickets that they get from people.
Mm-hmm.
And it could have been the police officers didn't even know that there'd been any kind of problem at a store earlier, but they saw two guys walking down the street and it looked like they were thought, well, here's a few more dollars.
We're going to harass them. Yeah. Here are two guys. We're just going to go and harass them.
Well,
it felt like it's okay.
That's been going on for centuries in Ferguson. The pot just boiled over. That's what happened.
From tickets and misdemeanors, they make over $2 million
a
year?
Yes. And they repeatedly, give you a failure to appear and you don't, and you already in court. And I mean, it's just been a whole lot of stuff going on in
Ferguson. You're from this area and that happened?
Yeah.
Has that happened to you?
Yes. Yes, me, my son, and members in my family. Yeah.
It seemed like, they had like over 40,000 of this.
Yes.
And there's only 21,000 people.
And we'll keep you for weeks for a traffic ticket.
And that has happened to you. They kept you for weeks.
Yes, not me.
But
family members.
Family members.
Yes.
And this is their second largest source of revenue in this community.
Right.
What's it going to take to change it all?
Unity, for one. And to serve God first.
Yes.
Yeah. See, you need Jesus in order to conquer anything.
And I think Jesus is definitely concerned with the fact that rich folks, when they get a ticket, all they get to do is hire a lawyer,
forget all
their points. Yeah. But poor people, they don't even give you the right of community service. You have to come up with the money, and if not, they lock you up.
A lot of them don't even know nothing about community service because nobody has ever even told them about it. That's a way out. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's sad.
But they lock them up like that. I understand Ferguson, they'll start the course 30 minutes early. If you're 5 minutes late, they lock
you can't get in.
You can't get in. You've seen some of this personally.
Yes. Yes. Sure have.
And raising your children in this area and having that go on, that adds a lot of pressure to you, doesn't it?
Of course. It's just, I don't know, it's just like a black-white thing, and I never want to be into a racial environment. Because Jesus loves all of us.
He sure does.
Okay, and it's been going on too long. That's why people are upset.
Even poor whites are still getting the tickets like that. But it's like a rich-poor thing. It just happens that the majority of the poor African-American, it looks like, which is tragic.
Right. True.
It just keeps on moving on. But maybe something good will come out of all this. What do you think?
Oh, yeah. If we stick together, and people like you and other people that's higher ups, you know, we'll make it.
That's what you're praying, that there'll be some change.
Yes, praying. Yes. Please.
But first off, they got to get to know their Savior.
Yeah. And tell me why you're saying that.
Because I'm a blessed person. I mean, you know,
how has that changed you? How has that enabled you to continue on in spite of these injustices
and
stand up?
I humble myself in the presence of the Lord. for a lot of things. As far as being all this violence and all that, I'm not into all that.
I mean, if the salt was taken out of this city, the believers were removed, all hell would break out.
That's why if I meet someone, I tell them about Jesus Christ. I spread the word. So that's the best thing to do.
Hello, my sisters and brothers. We are here from Atlanta, Georgia, because Dr. King was right, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. So as we stand at this place where our brother breathed his last breath, and as I look into the eyes of these grieving parents, let us be mindful that we are standing today on holy ground. And so will you bow with me in prayer? Gracious God, the blood of our brother cries from the grave. It cries for justice. It cries for peace. And through the eloquence of his witness, he reminds us that peace is not the absence of tension, it is the presence of justice. But justice will not come unless we awaken it. So we raise now our voices, crying out to God until justice wakes. First, we ask now your blessings upon these parents as they deal with the worst kind of grief, when nature is reversed and rather than the child burying the parent has to bury the child. There is nothing worse than that. So while this is a public discussion, they are dealing with private pain. And so we ask now that the God of all comfort, the one who wept at the graveside of Lazarus, will look now with mercy upon these parents. Give them the peace of God that surpasses human understanding. Now, O God, help us now to turn our pain into power. Teach us now how to transform our anger into righteous activism. Grant that the world will know that we did not raise our voices for just a few minutes, but that this is sustained moral indignation. This is sustained outrage. We thank you, O God, especially for these young people. Thank you for those young people. We thank you for their commitment. We did not come to condemn them. We've come to lift them up. With their voices, they are redeeming the very soul of America. Well, help us, O God, now to hear before it's too late, and let us not grow weary in well-doing as we stand now at this sacred ground where Mike Brown lost his life. We know that he is the latest, the most well-known in a long line of such tragedies. Remind us that not long ago we were protesting for our brother Trayvon Martin. And as these young people protest, remind them of God that it took 2 months to get Mr. George Zimmerman arrested. So let us not grow weary in well-doing. We will stay in these streets and continue to raise our voices, not only until Officer Houston is arrested, but until America itself is arrested. America will hear us say, you are under arrest. You do not have the right to remain silent. We do not know what to tell our our children, when they are confronted with the police, you do not have the right to remain silent. So give us now peace and power and courage and love for the living of these days and the facing of this hour. In the name of the God who is our Lord and our liberator, let the people of God say amen.
Hi, tell us your name.
Maria Boyd.
And you?
Tanetta.
And your sign talks about the need to register to vote and justice, and you're out here on behalf of Michael Brown, is that correct?
Correct.
What do you feel is important to be out here?
Well, it's important because justice should be served in all ways.
And you?
The same, justice should be served.
How do you feel about this?
I think justice will prevail.
I see a lot of people of faith out here, living out their faith. Is that your case?
That's true.
This is something that we feel that God wants us to do, is that correct?
That's right.
Yes.
So we have to stand up, let our voices be heard on behalf of so many that are in need, right?
And it takes prayer and outreach in the whole world.
Yes, so many needs.
We're from the Skinker de Bellevue neighborhood, and we're here to protest for transparency in this case, and we really believe that this has to be more just more transparent, and people need to know what happened, and they need to have the hope that this gets resolved so that Mike Brown, he gets validated, so that this is something that gives people hope.
My name is Zenobia Thompson.
And why are you here?
Well, I'm a longtime activist for justice. Mm-hmm. This is no aberration. I've been involved in struggles against police crimes for decades. You know, go back to 79, in the 80s, and in the 90s. And people are sick and tired of being sick and tired. They've just had enough. And so I'm here for justice.
It seems like the tip of the iceberg. The reason the officer pulled Mike Brown and the other gentleman over, they're walking down the middle of the street. A misdemeanor. It seems like they run this city on misdemeanors. Second source of revenue, over $2 million they made on misdemeanor fines last year in Ferguson.
Well, you know, that's not new to the African American community and the working class community that lives in these communities. I mean, you know, it's been revealed that these municipalities get over 50% of their budget revenue from tickets, you know. I mean, it's no fun. We know the game, and we're sick and tired of it. And, you know, it's just really, I should say, hard, even as much as they financially depend upon the kind of treatment, the rudeness, the disrespect, you know. So people are sick and tired of being treated as second-class citizens without respect and dignity. And most importantly, that our young African-American male's life is not of any value to a white person. And so that has to change. It has to change by the policies that we enact, you know, that assist and help our young people and the kind of games
that we play. It is encouraging you to see as time goes on here, there's more white faces out in these march?
Well, let me just say this. We're calling out to everyone.
Right.
Everyone who is for justice, who is for peace, who is for fairness is here. And you know, I will say this so very, very clearly. It is heartwarming to see the diversity in this group today, and that has been present. But we must be mindful that the right wing and its devious ways are busy, are very busy. And let me just say this in closing, you know, and I'm saying that we're calling out for people who are about justice, you know, and folks that they can do whatever they want to do. This is a free country. But supporters of the officer who killed this 18-year-old young man, you know, the supporters that are coming forth, let me think, that's a racist behavior, you know. That's racism. And you know, and we'll know them by, you know, what they do. So thank you.
Because of, I want fairness for the youth, for the young males, so that we won't have to anymore have a talk with them when they're little boys, letting them know that they got to conduct themselves in a different way than any other race. So I'm watching for young men, from boys on up, of every color. And you know, I just want justice for all people and unity. And I'm really thankful for the work that Reverend Rice does as far as the homeless, because there's not that many people in St. Louis that really stands up for the homeless. Thank you. My name is Sheila.
special. We're going to start off with Pastor Booker from the St. Paul AME Church in St. Louis, who is a part of our coalition, a strong fighter, and he's going to start off first with a Christian prayer.
Let us pray. Oh God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, shelter from the stormy blast, and you our eternal home. Before the hills in order stood, our earth received her frame. From everlasting to everlasting, thou art God, to endless years the same. 3 weeks later, we pause, God, to ask for answers. We know that you have the answer for this world today. Above you, there is none other. For we know that you are the way. We pray comfort for this mother, for this father, for this extended family today. Their hearts are heavy. A lost son is gone beyond the sky. We know that his life is not going to be in vain. We know that answers are going to come, with resolutions are going to come, new police policies are going to come. We pray for justice, God. We pray for the sick racial minds of some of our brothers and sisters who see our lives as beasts and animals. We know you're going to even the score, God. We know you're going to make the wrong right. The crooked place is straight and the wrong place is smooth.
All right now.
But there is a bomb in Gilead trying to make us free. There's a bomb in Gilead in our hearts that we want justice and we want it now. Jesus, bring peace and justice in Ferguson and in the hearts of these parents. In the name of Jesus.
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 I'll be lifted up. I'll draw all men unto me. We pray this prayer in Jesus' name. And it is so.
And it is so.
And
it is so.
What's your name?
Tracy Simmons.
And Tracy, you're out here, and you have something that says in celebration of Kelly Fowler. Tell us about Kelly.
He was my brother right next to me. He died suddenly about 5 years ago. It was a surprise to everybody in our family. But like my mom said, by prayer and faith, we made it. But I guess representing him today was important to me because he has experienced the police brutality in Ferguson before he passed, and my other brother, both, you know, kind of went through a lot of the crap in Ferguson.
What kind of police brutality?
Like my mom said, being locked up or stopped for stupid reasons, and mistreated, and then when they were locked up, never given the opportunity to even contact our mom for days. You know, we didn't know that they were in trouble for a day or two. You know, that's not usual. You should be able to contact somebody right away, you know. And one time I think my brother got what they considered to be smart with the police officer, and he was hit and stuff, you know, mistreated and everything. So, you know, it's a serious situation in Ferguson. The Ferguson is probably one of the biggest areas in North County that doesn't even care about the police brutality that they do to black men. And even to the lower class people who they consider not to be fortunate to have a lot of money, they just don't care how they treat them, you know. So we just continue to be prayerful and have faith in God that if we stand together like everybody doing today, that things will get better.
How did you? What do you say to your sons when they go through all this? I mean, and then you try to share the Jesus with them, and it's how do you continue to get them to keep on believing in the middle of all that?
Well, they be bitter, but they know they raised in a Christian home, so they know Jesus Christ.
And you have to keep on praying for them day and night.
That's right.
Just pray for them day and night.
Yeah, pray and never faint. You know.
I don't know if a lot of people understand what it's like trying to raise the kids, and then they get handcuffed. You didn't know where he was for days.
Right.
Lock them up.
Sit them on the curb, hands behind their back, handcuff them. It's horrible, but you know, this is, I believe this is going to be the thing that everybody needs.
So even weeks after Michael Brown is shot, the people aren't letting this go away, are they?
No, it's not. It's not going to go away, and not just because of what has happened to Michael Brown, but people are tired. You know, a lot of people can talk about family situations where people have been really hurt or wrongfully lost money that they didn't have because of how they were treated in Ferguson, you know. It's just a horrific situation, you know, even in the city of St. Louis.
It just really needs
to stop, period. You know, even after Michael Brown was killed, the young man that...
He was shot down by this St. Louis white policeman.
He was mentally ill,
yes.
You know, and that was a horrific situation to even have to witness something like that on television, let alone right there in the streets, you know.
He's going to get shot. He's so frustrated. Then he pulls out a kitchen knife, to say a steak knife, and they shoot him dead, even when they have tasers on him.
Instead of even trying to shoot the man in his legs. And I mean, I thought they were supposed to be to protect and serve us, not to kill and serve.
They said that they're training to kill right now.
You know, so, well, somebody need, but what if it was a shoot to kill order on the police? Then we as citizens would be wrong. And so, I just think it's unfair. It's totally unfair.
But we know that God understands because his son was killed at the hands of the authorities, right?
He sacrificed his life that every day we have a brand new mercy. So we have to trust and believe that just like he sees us through our everyday life, he'll see us out of this. And we have to really trust and believe it and stand on that word and stand on his promises and know that he's going to see us through.
And that's what you've been doing all these years.
Yes,
raising the kids in the middle of all this, trying to stand steadfast.
Yeah.
You stay in your Bible a lot?
Right, yes, of course.
Got to get in the Bible every day.
Yeah, steadfast and movable, you know. Yes. Trusting and believe. See, I have to hold on to God's unchanging hand. That's the only thing I know.
Yeah. And that's what gives us the strength to keep going on day after day.
Amen. That's true. The only way we're going to continue to go on every day is trusting God. You know, sometimes you want to do things your own way, but then you find when you make moves on your own, you make some stupid mistakes. There's some mistakes you can't turn back from. So, you know, he's the best thing that we could ever come into. So.
And I want to ask those of you that don't live in an environment like this to put yourself in these ladies' situation. You'd say you lived in a community that was all African-American police, and they were the majority, and your children are getting shot. It's not happening that way, though. I mean, put yourself in other people's situation. Understand what they're going through and the courts and
feel
the pain and have your children locked up, not know where they're at. And know that your community, the second largest source of revenue for that community was the tickets they were getting from your kids. That's the reality of what's happening in Ferguson right now. Not only in Ferguson and Florissant. They asked for a moratorium on these tickets, and Florissant turned around and raised the price $10 so they could build their new courthouse.
They're just as bad. Florissant is just as bad.
This is
I had to deal with my son with Florissant, so they're just as bad. You know, they may not be killing the kids, but the violence that they're doing is just as bad. So.
And this is what the people are facing on a day-by-day basis. And the Bible tells us those that remain steadfast to the end shall be saved. I've seen Jesus too much to turn around right now, haven't
we? Yes,
right. Seen him too many years he's been with us through all this, right?
He's not going to leave us.
And I think all this coming to the surface like this is God.
Yeah.
He said, let
he's tired.
So
let my people go. He's tired.
Let my people go.
That's
so
right.
So instead of believing the lies and rumors heard in the coffee shops, get out here and talk to the folks.
That's right.
Find out what this really encountering. Get to know what's going on. And that's what we desire to do through these programs, is to tell you the rest of the story.